Hello, David Diga Hernandez here, and welcome to another edition of Spirit Church. Are we living in the last days? If so, how important is it that we tap into the anointing of the Holy Spirit? I'm talking about the anointing for the end times today on Spirit Church. But first, as usual, Stephen Moctezuma is here with us, and he's going to be leading us in some worship.
He's a name above all names.
Now, at the risk of disappointing some of the viewers who tuned in because of the title having to do with the end times, I do want to clarify today that I am not going to be talking specifically about the end times. In other words, we're not going to get into eschatology. Today, I want to talk about the anointing and why it's important, especially these days that we have. And now, if you ask me personally, I believe that we are living in the last days. I mean, you look at all of the signs, you look at what the scripture has to say. I'm not one of those who says that you can pinpoint an exact time or date. Jesus said that that's not possible to do. So we have to just be prepared, and we have to live our Christianity. We have to do our ministries in the light of the return of Christ. It is imminent, and it could happen at any moment. Now, as to not alienate those who believe that a different type of eschatology, let me just say this. Whether or not you believe these to be the last days or not, today is somebody's last days. And that is enough to cause urgency within my heart. Let me say that again. Whether or not you believe these to be the last days, today is somebody's last day. And that is enough to cause me to preach the gospel with urgency. Now, also, whether or not you believe these to be the last days, you can agree that these are trying days. These are difficult days. These are tumultuous days. These are days filled with uncertainty. These are days that are filled with political unrest, financial instability, social and moral decline. I mean, disease is rampant. There are wars and there are rumors of wars. There are so many things going on in our world right now that are indicative of the last days described in the New Testament. Now, again, I don't want to alienate anybody based upon their eschatology. I know there are some parts of Christianity that believe differently about the last days, and that's fine. But what is important is that we as believers tap into the anointing of the Holy Spirit for these days. It is going to be difficult to preach the gospel in the coming days. And I believe there is a great sifting that is coming to the church. Now, that is no reason to fear. That is no reason to dread. You go on living your life, living your Christianity, living in peace, love, and joy, because we're taken care of by God. But we do have to be aware. We do have to be wise. We do have to be alert and awake to our surroundings and the things that are happening. I'm telling you, I believe that this message is going to bless many of you, because it's going to talk to you about being prepared with the anointing. We need to be prepared with the anointing, because we have to face the things that the days are bringing to us. Now, the scripture says in Matthew 25, we're going to go right over to that. This is the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, or the 10 virgins. This is what the scripture says. It says, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five of them were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps, but the other five were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, 'Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him.' All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, 'Please, give us some of your oil, because our lamps are going out.' But the others replied, 'We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves.' But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other five bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, 'Lord, Lord, open the door for us.' But he called back, 'Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return.'" So Jesus is very specifically speaking of his return. And I believe this parable is talking about the church. And I'll tell you why. The scripture is talking about 10 bridesmaids, or as the King James puts it, 10 virgins. This is not a matter of purity, but of preparation. All 10 of the women in the story were pure, but only 5 of them were prepared. All 10 of them were justified. They were righteous. But only 5 of them were prepared to meet the Lord at his coming. Now, what's interesting here is, number one, when it comes to the anointing, and we see in verse 4, it says, "But the five others were wise enough to take along extra oil." Number one, you need a good supply. Now, I'm not talking about the person of the Holy Spirit, because the person of the Holy Spirit is eternal, and he does not come in portions. He is not handed to us in intervals. The Holy Spirit is complete and whole in himself, and when you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you, you have all that you need to live as a Christian. But what I'm talking about is the anointing, the power of God that comes upon your life from surrendering to the Holy Spirit who is within you. Now, that I can go on with for several minutes, but I don't want to take from the lesson here. So I want to just talk to you about how you basically need, whether you want to equate it to being an amount or you equate it to being a type of persistence, we do know that you do need to supply yourself for the long haul. A lot of Christians, they become weary. They start to lose that energy, that passion, that fire, that ambition, that desire to do things for God as time goes on. They start off good. They come ready. They come prepared. They said, "Lord, I'm waiting for your return. In the meantime, I'm going to preach the gospel and try to win souls." And they go about it with passion. They go about it with the fire. By the way, the oil kept the fire alive in their lives. The oil kept the light of truth burning. The scripture says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." The word of God is often described as a light or a fire or a lamp. And their lamps that they had were fueled by the oil. So the light of truth is fueled by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And so they didn't have a good supply. They ran out. And I want to encourage you, especially in these times, in these difficult times, there's going to be a lot of pushback. There's going to be a lot of pressure against the church. There are going to be a lot of Christians who take sides with things that are anti-biblical. Let me tell you something. Especially in our generation, and I'm speaking as a millennial, I'm not trying to speak criticism, but I'm just speaking truth here. And that's something I promise to always do for you on these programs, is to just tell you the truth of what the Bible teaches. And can I just be honest with you? The millennials, our generation, the problem is that a good majority of our generation has tapped into some very unbiblical ideas, and because it's so instilled into us, let me tell you something, the colleges that we're going to, the universities that we're going to, the school systems that we're being run through are very anti-biblical, and the problem is that they're programming an entire generation to think incorrectly. So when it comes to millennials, some of the myths we believe, I'll just give you one example. They say to each his own. Not only is that logically inconsistent within itself, but that only works so long as each doesn't actually believe its own. The other one is, we don't want to offend anybody. People are so afraid of offending other people that they won't speak the truth. And that's an issue. That's a problem. Because Jesus never worried about offending people. I don't care what anyone says, Jesus was not worried about offending people. The apostles were not worried about offending people. That is something that believers need to grow out of. We got to stop allowing people's feelings to stop the preaching of the truth. Really, love is truth in action. And the most loving thing that you can do for someone is preach the truth to them. So we've got to stop putting feelings before truth, and that's something that millennials do. Another thing, I mean, you talk about entitlement. No generation has ever had this sense of entitlement. I hope I'm not stepping on too many toes here, but again, this is just the biblical truth. I mean, and we have this entitlement mentality, this welfare mentality in our generation. When we look at the parable of the talents, the Lord took from those who had little and gave to those who had much because they were good stewards of what they had. I know, not something that everyone wants to hear, but let me tell you something, it's the biblical truth. And so, up against this type of thinking, up against this type of deception, really, that has crept into the church, that pressure is not just going to come from the world, it's not just going to come from within the church, it's going to come from those who think with their emotions rather than thinking based upon the Word of God. And they're gonna cause the feelings to take the place of truth. And in other words, if it feels offensive, if it feels like it bothers, if it feels like it hurts someone's feeling, then it can't possibly be the truth, and that's how they think. And so we have to be ready in these times, because the let me tell you something, the pressure is coming against the church. We have to be ready for the long haul. We have to be ready and filled with oil, and we have to be determined to not just make it for the next few days, not just for the next few weeks, not just for the next few months, but for the long haul, to dedicate the rest of our lives to the preaching of truth, to the expansion of the kingdom of God. We need a good supply. We cannot be like these five virgins who at the last minute ran out and didn't have enough to finish the job. We have to determine in our minds right now, Lord, no matter what comes against me, Lord, no matter what the culture says, Lord, no matter what the nation says, what the nations say, Lord, no matter what the deceived say, I'm going to stand for your truth. And this is not about an us against them mentality. On the contrary, I believe we are to love everyone, and we want to win them over to the truth. And so we have to be involved. We have to be loving. We have to be polite. Love is not rude. But I'm talking about this cowardly mentality that allows the pushback to silence and therefore snuff out the light. And because of the pressure that comes against us, we in the late hour lose the fire. We need a supply for the long haul. We cannot be like the five foolish who had enough just until right the very end. Make up your mind, determine now. You're going to stand for truth. You're going to stand for the word. And let me encourage my generation. We need to allow our minds, our belief systems, our perspectives, our policies, our ideology, they need to line up to the Word. They need to take a back seat to what the truth of the Word. A Christian looks first to the Word and second to his ideas and ideologies. We need to put the Word of God first. And if we're going to do that, we need to be in it for the long haul, because the pressure is coming. And I'm saying that as an encouragement, because the greater the pressure against the church, the greater the power within the church, and our ability to win actually increases. In fact, I believe the Jesus People movement, that movement that happened in the 70s, occurred much in a culture like this, where the spiritual vacuum is being created. It's like a dry brush has swept across the land because of the famine, because of the lack of the springs of the living water of the Holy Spirit. And that dryness is really just preparation for the fire of the Holy Spirit to spread. So be ready, a revival is coming, be encouraged. Now, number two, as we see in verse 5-7, it says, "When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, 'Look, the bridegroom is coming, come out and meet him.'" Number two, you need the anointing in seasons of weakness. So number one, you need a good supply. You need to be determined to come at this for the long haul. Number two, you need it for seasons of weakness where you feel like giving up, where you feel like spiritually falling asleep. Now, remember the disciples fell asleep and Jesus came to them. He said, "Couldn't you pray with me for 1 hour?" And he came back to them. Now, What is most striking to me from that story, where the disciples fell asleep while Jesus wanted them to stay awake and pray with him for at least an hour, was that eventually Jesus stopped pulling on them. Eventually, Jesus stopped calling them to the place of prayer. Now, make what you will of that, but the truth is that we do need the anointing for the seasons of weakness, and we all will face seasons of weakness. We all will face seasons where we sort of lose the passion for what we're doing. That's why you need to rely on the anointing of the Holy Spirit, because if it's in your power that you're doing something, the moment your strength begins to fail, so the ministry will begin to fail. But if you do what you do in the strength of the Holy Spirit, then even when you falter, what you do won't. What you do for the kingdom of God will stand strong in the midst of everything else falling apart. I can honestly tell you that this ministry, this broadcast that you're watching, is from a ministry that does not rest on the strength of any one man. This ministry, everything that we do, rests on the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit, because we need the anointing for moments of weakness. We need the anointing for when we feel like falling asleep. That oil keeps the light burning, and the light keeps you wide awake. The truth of the Word of God will keep you awake. It'll keep you alert. It'll keep your heart set aflame and your heart ablaze for Jesus. But you need that oil to continue to cause that flame to burn. So number one, you need a good supply. You need it for the long haul. Number two, you need it for seasons of weakness. Now look at verse 8. The scripture says this: "Then the five foolish ones asked the other, 'Please give us some of your oil, because our lamps are going out.'" Number three, you need your own supply. You cannot get the anointing from someone else. Now, I understand that through impartation, we receive the capacity for certain gifts. We receive the capacity for the power of God. We receive the capacity for the revelation that is passed to us. But we cannot receive the empowering of the Holy Spirit unless we seek it for ourselves. So in other words, through laying on of hands, you can receive the vehicle that God has given you. You can receive the gift, the vehicle, but you cannot receive the fuel from someone else. You need to go to the source to get your own supply. You cannot rely on your parents. You cannot rely on your relatives. That's why you'll often see ministries, large ministries historically, they get handed to family members. And the family members had the name, but they didn't have the anointing. They weren't the ones God intended to take on the legacy or the torch of what God wanted to do. And because they weren't anointed, everything fell apart. You can't be anointed by relation. You can't be anointed because you know a pastor, or because you have a friend who's in ministry, or because your family name is known as minister, because you've been given a title in ministry. You cannot receive the anointing like that. You need your own supply. And your own supply comes in from the depths of prayer, when you're seeking the presence of God, when you're seeking the face of Jesus on your own. You need your own supply. I believe that especially in these times, this generation, my generation, we're growing so tired of the disingenuous. And a lot of ministries pander to our generation, and they shouldn't be pandering. They shouldn't be condescending with with games and lights, and those are all wonderful things, and they have their place, but we want the real. We want the tangible. We want the power. And our generation now, we've been introduced to the person of Jesus, but we're seeking the depths now. We want to go deeper. We want to move beyond self-help. We want to move beyond a little bit of encouragement to help me reach success. And we want to know the depths of the presence of the Holy Spirit. We want to know the person, the being, the glory, the magnificence that is Jesus. And that comes through personal connection by revelation of the Holy Spirit and getting on your face before God and seeking Him with all of your heart. So number three, you need your own supply. And I believe you believe that. Now, number four, we find in verse 9, the scripture says, "But the others replied, 'We don't have enough for us all. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves.'" Number four, you need to pay the price. So number one, you need a good supply. That's talking about the long haul. Number two, you need it for seasons of weakness. This is the seasons that'll keep you from falling asleep. Number three, you need your own supply. And number four, you need to pay the price. The anointing does not come on you without having paid a price. If you want the power of God on you, and again, I'm just giving you the truth here. If you want the power of God to come upon you, you need to pay a price for it. Now you may say, "But Jesus paid it all." No, no, no. Jesus paid for your salvation. But the power progressively comes on your life, as according to John chapter 3, verse 30, as you decrease and He increases. Paul the Apostle says, "I die daily." Ephesians chapter 4, I believe verse 1, tells us to walk worthy of the call. The scripture talks about growing in the Spirit, growing in the Word, growing in the power, growing in the truth, growing in the knowledge, growing in the person of Christ. And we grow because there are levels. And if you can grow in something, it means there are levels to it. There are levels of the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and God wants to take you to greater levels. You may be discouraged and looking around and saying, "God, I don't know how I could possibly move to greater realms." It's going to come when He processes you. God will process you before He empowers you. Before the power will come on your life, you need a little bit of pressure to come upon your life. You know how the anointing oil is made? It comes from olives. And do you know what they have to do to that olive before they can get the oil to come out of it? They have to press it. They have to crush it. The pressing, the crushing, the bruising brings out the anointing. You may be up under a lot of pressure right now. You may feel like there are many things. You may be looking around and there's chaos, there's calamity. People aren't talking to you. And if they're not talking to you, they're just talking about you. And if they're not, talking about you, then you're being betrayed. Things are falling apart here. Things are falling apart there. Finances are tight. You're not seeing a push and a breakthrough like you want to see. Guess what? You're being processed. You're being prepared. You know, the anointing was used for several reasons. In fact, I have a list here. I didn't plan on talking about this, but I just want to talk to you about this. The anointing was used to appoint people, as with kings. You can see an example of that in 2 Kings chapter 9. I believe the first few verses, the anointing was used to appoint priests, and there's an example of that in Exodus chapter 40, verse 15. And so the anointing is used to appoint, to assign, or position. The anointing is used to also devote or to consecrate, to separate unto Himself. God will anoint someone. The anointing is devotion. It's the setting apart. When you're anointed, you are set apart. We see an example of that in Exodus chapter 28, verse number 41. So number one, the anointing appoints. That's to assign or to position. The anointing is to consecrate. That's to devote you, to set you apart. Number three, the anointing is for impartation. We see that in 1 Samuel with David being anointed by Samuel to be king. He was anointed to be king. He was imparted. He was set aside for that. So number one, the anointing appoints. It's used to consecrate. It's used to impart. Number four, it's used to deliver. I believe it's Isaiah chapter 10 that talks about the anointing breaks the yoke of bondage. And then number five, it's used to prepare people. The anointing was used to prepare bodies for burial unto death. So it's used to appoint, to devote, or consecrate, to impart, to deliver, and to prepare the dead. Talk about paying the price. The anointing was used on the dead. Are you ready to die? Are you ready to die to self? Are you ready to consecrate and devote and be set apart? I remember I went to a youth conference one year, and I was about maybe 14, 15 years old. And the youth pastor pulled me aside. He said, "Can I just tell you something?" He said, "I noticed something very different about you." He says, "I watched this entire conference, and it was like a getaway. You know, you rent the hotel, you go out, and, you know, it's a lot of fun time for fellowship as well." And the youth pastor, his name is Mondo Luna, he told me, he said, "You know, I watched this whole week, and this entire week, every morning I saw you reading the Word and praying. When others were going out to do pranks or to go fellowship, he says, I saw you do that too." He says, "But I saw you set a time every day of the week to pray and to get a hold of God. You're under the anointing. You got to pay the price. You got to be set apart." You know, there are a lot of things I missed out on. You got to remember, I started in the ministry when I was 13. I'm 26 today. I don't regret it at all. But there were a lot of things I missed out on, good and bad, for the anointing. There'd be times where I'd be in a movie theater watching a movie, and if something came on that screen that grieved the Holy Spirit, I may have paid my $10, I think it was $8 back then, but I would stand up and I'd walk out of that movie theater. And everyone I was with would say, "Oh, there he is being religious. Oh, there he is being overboard." I would pray when no one else was praying. I would seek God, and this isn't to brag on myself. I'm telling you a testimony of having paid the price, because you can pay the price too. You have to be set apart. You have to be different. You have to be unique. You know, when you get saved, you're going to lose a lot of ungodly friends. But when you become anointed of God, you also lose a lot of lukewarm friends. They become offended. They become jealous. They become, they don't know how to handle you. And that's okay. But if you want the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you have to pay the price. You have to go through a process. And there were times in my life where I cried out to God. I said, "God, just take me home. I can't handle what I'm handling." And I'm so glad he didn't, because it was in those times, that crushing, where I found the anointing. And every tear that you cry for the sake of the kingdom, consider it a drop in the veil. Consider it a drop of anointing. Every tear that you cry for the kingdom of God, every tear that you cry for the glory of God, consider it a drop of the anointing on your life. You have to pay the price. And finally, number five, you need it for distinction. Verse 12, the scripture says that when the master looked out, but he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you." He didn't recognize them. They were invited. They were virgins. They were pure. They could have been in. Because they had no oil, they had no light, and the master didn't recognize them. The anointing distinguishes you. You need it for distinction. Moses said, "Lord, I'm not going to go anywhere your presence doesn't go, because if you don't go with me, everything's going to fall apart. And God, if I don't have your presence on my life, I don't have your power with me, how are they going to know me and your children from all the other nations? How are they going to even be able to tell us apart?" The anointing of God on your life is the distinction of God upon your life. It's what makes you distinct. So number one, you need a good supply. Number two, you need it for seasons of weakness. Number three, you need your own supply. It's personal. Number four, you need to pay the price. Number five, you need it for distinction. And finally, number six, you need it to preserve the truth. Remember, the oil preserved the light. The anointing preserves the truth. God is looking for a man or a woman. Let me tell you something. God will use you if you just make yourself available. God's eyes are moving across the earth, and he's looking for someone who he can use. God is looking for an individual who will stand for righteousness. You know, some of the sin in your life that's private right now, it may never come out. The scripture does say everything gets exposed, but, you know, if you repent, God can forgive it. But the truth is that private sin may be silencing a public ministry that you should have one day. This is why we need the anointing. It preserves the truth in our lives. But not only that, it preserves the truth in our mouth. God is looking for someone who will live righteously, stand up and be bold, and lovingly and courageously, no, those two are not exclusive to one another. They can be done together. To lovingly and courageously declare that there is no other name under heaven whereby we must be saved other than the name of Jesus. To lovingly and courageously declare that Jesus is the way, that Jesus is the truth, that Jesus is the life, and that no man comes to the Father but by Him. That we are not going to find the truth in Islam. We're not going to find the truth in Buddhism. We're not going to try find the truth in the Hindu religion. We're not going to find the truth in a politician. We're not going to find the truth in the messages that Hollywood portrays. But that we are only going to find the truth, the hope of the nations, the hope for humanity, the cure for the disease of sin that is rampant in this generation, the light that shines in the darkest of places, the liberation that comes across to the captives and declares that they can be free from the death that comes from sin, that only through Jesus does any of that come. And God is looking for someone who will, with the anointing of God on their life, declare that and not care who they will offend, though they love, though they're not trying to be rude, though they're not trying to offend, will not care if the truth offends. I am sick and tired. I don't know about you. I am tired of preachers dancing around topics and not just saying, this is what the Bible says. I'm tired of men with persuasive words who are trying so very hard to be liked by the systems that reject Jesus the person, Jesus the Christ. I'm looking for a generation, and God is looking for a generation. I'm looking to unite with the people who will stand boldly and say, I'm for Jesus, I'm for the truth of the Word of God. This is it, this is the reality, and on this I stand, on this rock I stand, I shall not be moved. And if you will boldly declare that, then you're anointed. The anointing preserves the truth. We need the truth. The truth is the light that goes into the darkest of places and allows the eyes of the unredeemed to be opened to see the great hope that lay before them. The truth, believer, child of God, the truth is what will set them free. Oh, it may offend people, but the truth will set them free. Do you love people enough to declare the truth? We have to grow out of dancing around these issues. We have to grow out of this fear, this hypersensitivity to offending people. There have been times I've been offended by the people I most love when they got in my face and said, this is what you need to hear. So to recap and to close, we need the anointing. And we need the anointing. Number one, you need a good supply. Number two, you need it for seasons of weakness. Number three, you need your own supply. Number four, you need to pay the price. Number five, you need it for distinction. And number six, you need it to preserve the truth. I want to pray with you now. And I'm going to believe God that as you watch this right now, oh, there's someone watching that you're so hungry for the depths of Christ. And you want to move deeper. You want the truth. The presence of God is here. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is here. I'm going to pray that the anointing of the Holy Spirit, remember, He's the only one who can give it. You have to ask Him. That the anointing of the Holy Spirit would come upon you now. I can tell you, we get written emails from us all to us all the time, letters, emails, comments, where people feel the very presence of God as they're watching the video. Lord, in Jesus' name, let that one watching experience the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we stand at the threshold of historic times. We are approaching the greatest hour that the church has ever known. And so, Father, I pray that as we come up against the greatest opposition that the church has ever known, that, Lord, we would know the greatest anointing that the church has ever known. Lord, let us in this hour see revival such has never been recorded in all of the history books. Father, I pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to come on that one watching. Lord, let them be bold. Let them be courageous. Let them be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, let us see miracles. Let us see people redeemed. Let us see lives transformed. I pray right now that the power of the Holy Spirit would begin to flow and be transferred right now. Touch that one watching. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And you said, amen. I don't know about you, but I feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit here, and I'm excited for what God is going to do through your life. Listen, we're not critical. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just here to present some solutions to, I believe, some major problems that have been happening. And let me tell you, I love all of our brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm not trying to criticize anybody. I just want you to know that you should not be afraid. You're not alone. There are other believers who recognize that there's a need to stand for truth. So you go and you do that, anointed of the Holy Spirit of God. And remember, always do it in love. Now, as usual, I got to take up an offering, and I have to do this. We need this. We need support to help continue to do what we want to do for the kingdom of God. God has mandated what we do, and we have to continue to that calling. So as usual, if you're blessed by this ministry, if you're a member of Spirit Church, which now we have almost 100 members, 100 official members who have declared, who have signed up, who have officially joined as a member of Spirit Church, where this is their church. We have almost 100 official members. Now, those of you who are official members, this is where you tithe, this is where you give your offering. Please do that today. Don't delay. And those of you who are watching who don't necessarily want to call this your church, but you watch Encounter TV, you come to the Encounter services, maybe you've read some of our books, but you love this event. It's an evangelistic ministry primarily. So we still need partners. We still need supporters who will help do that. Become a $30 a month partner today. Help us in what we're doing. Steve, could you grab me a copy of Carriers of the Glory, please? This was put on my heart. If you become a $30 a month partner, bring it on down this way, and you got to get back to your guitar to do worship soon. If you're willing to become a $30 a month partner or more, you can become a $30 a month, $100 a month, $50 a month, but $30 a month or more, I'm going to send you a copy of Carriers of the Glory signed. All you have to do is when you sign up to become a partner, tell them I said that you can get your signed copy of Carriers of the Glory, and they'll make sure you specify signed, because otherwise the office won't know that I need to sign it. So tell them that you're watching Spirit Church and that you wanted this offer. So you sign up today to become my partner for $30 a month. Remember, I need 1,000 new $30 a month partners if we're going to expand to the next level. Become a partner today. Remember, it's all about the gospel. Sinners need to be saved. People need to hear the gospel. This is why we do international television, worldwide events, and global discipleship. This, what you're watching, Spirit Church, is just one of the three arms of David Hernandez Ministries. And this is the discipleship arm where we edify the believer. The Encounter services, we evangelize the lost. And then on television, we expand both evangelism and edification. So become a $30 a month partner today. You're going to get this book, Carriers of the Glory, Becoming a Friend of the Holy Spirit. Also, we take one-time donations as well. We appreciate you. We love you. I'm praying for you. Support today. Until next time, remember, oh, you know what? I almost forgot. August 30th, I'm coming to Orange, California. That's going to be our only official Encounter service of the year. I'm preaching all over. We're doing evangelistic events of all other kinds, but this is the only Encounter service that we're doing in Orange, California. It's one night, Sunday, August 30th at 7 o'clock p.m. I'd love to see you there. If you have to take a road trip down, get down. If you have to cancel something, cancel something. Get down there. I believe God's going to do something very special there. So I want to see you there. Now, remember, until next time, nothing is impossible with God.